This is TLB1.
TLB1 Radio.
Great, great mixture.
I like Tel Aviv.
This is TLB1.
This is
Tel Aviv is a beautiful city.
Great city, great radio.
TLB1.
This is TLB1.
The Tel Aviv Review with Gilad Halpern.
Hello and welcome to the Tel Aviv Review, a program dedicated to the word, to the thought, and to debate. I am your host, Gilad Halpern. Each week I'll be engaging in close encounters of the intellectual kind with writers, scholars, researchers, documentary filmmakers, or simply people who have done something to make our lives a tad more interesting. And on our show today, we'll be talking to Professor Marian Turski. He's the chairman of the Council of the Museum of the History of Polish Jews that recently opened in Warsaw. He will tell us about the relatively few Polish Jews who chose to stay in their native country after the Second World War, despite persistent attempts to eliminate their presence there. Our second guest will be Ruthie Pliskin, a social psychologist at Tel Aviv University and the Interdisciplinary Center in Herzliya, who studies the role of emotions in determining political action and affiliation. She will tell us about the interrelation between ideology and emotion and where left-wingers differ from right-wingers when it comes to that. That is our show today. Do stay with us. We'll be back right after this musical break.
Stop me up, I'll never stop.
You're listening to the Tel Aviv Review here on TLV1, and I'm now joined by Professor Marian Turski. He's the chairman of the board of the Museum of the History of Polish Jews. It recently opened in Warsaw. We're here to talk about the Jewish community in post-war Poland. Hello, Professor Turski. Thank you for joining us.
Fine. Thank you. I'm happy.
So, let's go back to 1945. The war ends, the German occupation is replaced by a Soviet one. The Jewish community that numbered several millions on the eve of the war is all but decimated, and most of the few who remained in the country choose to leave it, some to Israel, some to the West. Now, I'd like to focus on those who remained. How many were they, and where did they go?
Well, a very good question, a very hard answer. I tell you why. Because out of the 6 million Jews who... is the 3 million Jews who lived in Poland, 3.4 million, really, after the war, survived what we do know for sure at the beginning. Not 45, 44, because the first part of Poland was liberated in 44. And immediately there was established the Jewish community, and one of the Jewish leaders, a Zionist, Mr. Sommerstein, even became member of the new government, of the current government. Mm-hmm. It is peculiar. However, it happened why? Because the new regime, the new authorities, they promised to give absolutely equal rights to Jews, and this was one of the, I would say, of the acts of the death which was already done. It was to introduce, to invite a member, a Jewish leader, to the government. It will change afterwards, but nevertheless, so it started. And this is also a very peculiar, emphasizing as a historian, a factor that all the Jewish parties, including anti-communists before the war, including Bundes, which were anti-communists, mm-hmm. including religious parties beside but Agudat Israel. And so 11
the
parties...
The ultra-Orthodox party.
They were not especially pro-supporting the new regime, but not against the new mm-hmm. regime. So this was a phenomenon that all the Jewish parties, they backed, supported the new regime. Mm-hmm. Why? Probably, and for sure, because the communist underground was very much anti-Semitic. For the underground, it was something just to equalize. Jews, it means communists, it means Russians, it means our enemy.
So they thought that the communist regime would provide for their equal rights?
Would protect them. Mm-hmm. And would give them, a new chance. That, you see, well, so this is why it was not very much, only 10% of the Jewish population, people who survived. However, it was still a little chance to build a new galut, a new diaspora.
Yeah, so there's a more basic question than that. Why did they choose to stay in Poland that made it utmost to reject them?
Now, I'm going to explain it. But still, there were murders on Jews, which we show in our museum. Jews murdered, that still the people were expelled from the little towns where they wanted to regain their property. They were killed very often, and at least they were offended. So they got it rather in small, larger cities, particularly in the Western territories. And this is a new phenomenon, because in the Western territories, which were, which were occupied, they were former German, 700 years prior to they were Polish, they were really, but for 700 years they were Germanized. Lower Silesia, the Western territories, and now it was...
There had been, just to make clear, part of Germany up until the war.
Yes, yes, of course. The eastern part of Germany was granted to Poland due to the Potsdam Conference, which was in a way a compensation for the eastern territories given up, given to the Soviets.
Yes.
Western Ukraine, Western Belarus, and part of Lithuania. So, nevertheless, because there were still Jews were killed, they escaped. What, how was, which were the main reasons? Well, we try also to present it in our museum, the reasons. First reason, people didn't want living on a cemetery. Well, this is, this was a great Beit Kvarot, a great cemetery of the Jews, and therefore people didn't want, they came to Poland to try to find their relatives. If they found, okay, if not, they would go away from a place which became the cemetery.
Yeah, but also very little of the life prior to the war remained,
yes.
Right?
Secondly, for part of them, there was a new chance. You know, always there was a dream of all Poles, including Jews, going to America, living in America, behind the ocean. And there was a new possibility. It was opened a new possibility. Third factor. Now, next factor. People, there was a new chance going to Palestine. It was also a dream, I wouldn't say of the majority of the Jews in Poland, but of a great deal of them going to Palestine, and including those who were dedicated Zionists, and they wanted to go to Palestine, to go to lend a hand in building a new state.
Yeah.
And then, after 48, it was a new phenomenon, the birth of the State of Israel.
Sure.
And this was absolutely stimulating for very many people going to Israel.
But the, okay, that's very convincing, but what about those who remained? How come they weren't convinced by those arguments?
Yes. Now, who remained? Who remained? Remained people like, first of all, remained people, there was still a lot, well, I would say 10% of the Jewish population before the war, they were, I wouldn't call it assimilated, as they were the, as were the German Jews, the Yekis, but they were acculturated, they were involved in the Polish language, in Polish culture, well, in the Polish world, milieu, and therefore, Polish was their first language. Second, there were people, and this was a great part before the war, who were close to Yiddishkeit, which was called, which is, it is not Jewishness, it is Yiddishkeit, it's the people bound, attached to the Yiddish language, to Yiddish culture. Very many of them, Bundists, which were anti-Zionists. The Bundists were anti-Zionists.
Yes.
They were, to those who don't know, they were socialists, with an option of an autonomy in their homeland, which was Poland.
Yes.
So, well, this was another. There were the communists, who, or those people who wanted to change, as they believed in those days, the atmosphere, the climate, the political relations in Poland, in, as they believed in those days, in the spirit of brotherhood, of solidarity, and so on and so on.
How many of them were communist?
How many? Well, probably about 5-10% of those who survived.
Okay, so they weren't really supporters of the regime.
They escaped to the Soviet Union. Then they were in the Polish army, which liberated Poland. And there was a mutual influence.
Mm-hmm. But they didn't stay necessarily because they saw the new regime as a promise.
Well, you should also take into consideration that for very many Jews, in the 30s, Poland was very much with a growing anti-Semitism.
Mm-hmm.
Very close, even it was not like the Nazi anti-Semitism, but still it was a hatred. And therefore, the communists to them seemed to be in those days, well, something opposite to a fascism, to a xenophobia, something which was supporting ethnic minorities, and so on.
How soon were they disillusioned?
You should follow and watch the process of growing anti-Semitism in the Soviet Union, which started already at the end of the 40s with crushing the so-called anti-fascist committee with the famous Micho Eres, the actor who was the chief, the boss of it,
mm-hmm.
with people like him. And afterwards, which was the high point was with the trial of the so-called of the doctors in 51.
Yes.
In the meantime, was a process of kicking out the Jews from any post, and this was the great disillusion, but not yet in Poland. Not yet in Poland. In Poland, really, in Poland, the authorities were betting the Jewish community because the main enemy for them was the underground, anti-communist underground, which
yes.
was very much anti-Jewish. So you see how it was complicated. Nevertheless, I would say that out of those 250,000 of Jews who survived, mainly in the Soviet Union, due to the Soviet Union, because if there were some 20,000, 25,000, well, let's say, who came back from the camps. There were some 45, 50,000 who survived being hidden on the so-called Aryan side,
mm-hmm.
among them people like my wife, who was on Christian papers,
right.
doing as a Christian. And behaving as a Christian, so only hiding her identity, and another half who were just hidden in cellars, in different places,
yeah.
In hidden rooms. So this would be altogether about we estimate some 45,000-50,000.
And then the rest came from the Soviet Union?
Then about 5,000 to 8,000 Jews who were in the forest, in the partisan movement, or hidden like in the Bielski unit. Probably mm-hmm. you know the famous Bielski unit, which was a family camp and a family resistance. And the rest came back from they survived the Soviet Union. This is true.
Okay, I want to ask you, to direct it maybe to a more personal level to you yourself. You were born in Poland. You survived the war, and yet you decided to stay in Poland after the war, all those years. What led you specifically to still believe that Poland is your homeland?
I will tell you very frankly, and this is the first time maybe when I speak to the radio about it, because people know my CV. I was raised in a very dedicated Zionist family. So far that I can tell you that my father, who was a well-known Zionist, was part of the Kfutza, which made Aliyah to establish, to found Dgania Beit.
Right.
He himself, in the last moment, couldn't go because he was demanded, he was required, he was very demanded to be part of them because he was a soldier in the First World War, so they needed soldiers.
Yes.
But he was wounded very heavy in his lungs, and just before the Aliyah, he was very, very ill. Therefore, he didn't want to be a burden to his Haverim, to the Kfutza, which went to build the Dgania Beit.
Yeah, the famous kibbutz, yeah.
Yeah. It was the beginning of the 20s.
Yes.
And then, so I was raised in the spirit of Zionism. I attended a Hebrew high school, one of the few really Hebrew high schools, gymnasiums and lycees before the war. And so I spoke with my father only Hebrew at home, with my mother only Polish. She didn't speak
That's interesting.
Hebrew. Not Yiddish at all. And then, and he was proud of me because I was best in Ivrit in the school. Mm-hmm. And then, in the time of the ghetto, because I was in the ghetto of Lodz, and because, and you know, youngsters, I was 15 years old, I wanted to do something, and the most active was the communist movement. Right. They didn't call them communists, they called them Levica Związka, which means left. Mm-hmm. However, they were in matter of fact communists. And I heard very much my father, my beloved father. I heard him when he understood that I tried to join the communist movement because it was the most active and I wanted to do something. So I was, as you call it, Bamachteret Kommunist. Well, I was in this underground. So this was, in a way, a change in my life. After very many hesitations, because I was raised in another spirit. But those were the choices, alternatives for people who wanted to do something, for youngsters.
So when you became a communist of sorts, did you become anti-Zionist at the same time?
Well, I won't say anti-Zionist. I decided to be here and to build a new socialist Poland. And therefore, I'll tell you, I survived two death marches. One from Auschwitz to Buchenwald, and second one in the last days of the war from Buchenwald to Theresienstadt. In Theresienstadt, after having been recovered, it lasted 2 months, or even longer, in a field hospital. I was offered what was my dream. I wanted always to be a scholar. It was my dream, and I was offered either a scholarship to Great Britain or to Canada or to the United States. And I rejected all of them and returned back to the poor, destroyed Poland.
And you never regretted it?
Hmm?
You never regretted having done that?
Well, listen, because my life was really interesting, why should I regret? And afterwards, I'll tell you, I wanted you to understand. Then you might ask me, and why didn't you leave after the anti-Semitic campaign when there was not more possibility to believe in this regime?
That was in the late 60s you're talking about, right?
Yeah. This was out of solidarity. And this is a special chapter, as the Germans say, ein Kapitel für sich, another chapter, because I was then editor of a paper which was the only, the unique, which was anti-Semitic.
Right.
Which we fought the new wave. We were endangered because of it. It is the name was quite well known as the word Politica. And in this paper, out of 30 people, were 9 Jews and all the staff, but one, supported the Jews and supported the fight against anti-Semitism. And therefore, I had still a chance to leave. My friends, my colleagues, my comrades didn't have this chance.
Yeah.
So they were in solidarity with me. I was in solidarity with them.
Right.
I was to be.
And you never lost hope?
No, this is something else. And then, well, to be true, in after the 60s, there was also a change, well, coming back to Jewishness. Well, coming back, it was never hidden.
Already starting in the late 60s.
But coming back in this meaning that I should active do something for Jewishness. And in this case, listen, after all those waves of emigration for Poland of the Jews, when out of those 250, maybe 300,000, we left only not more than 20,000. I was offered very often to come to Israel to work in Yad Vashem. I was very close cooperator with Yad Vashem, and I'm still.
But Poland was forever your home.
But I think that. Then I decided somebody is to be Hashomer, arranger, a custodian of this Jewish heritage. And I will say in with the words of the Talmud, and if not me, if not myself, who should do it?
Yeah.
And when, if not now, because I was man who was involved in the Polish culture as a writer, as a journalist, as a public person. I was one of those few who knew Hebrew and Yiddish,
yeah.
And who was able to do more than anybody else.
That is really admirable.
Not admirable. Maybe this is my debt to my father.
Yeah, maybe. Okay, Professor Marian Turski, thank you so much for talking to us.
Thank you.
Me out like I-
You're listening to the Tel Aviv Review here on TLV1. Welcome back. I am now joined here in the studio by Ruthie Pliskin. She's a social psychologist at Tel Aviv University and the Interdisciplinary Center in Herzliya, whose research focuses on the role of emotions in determining political action or political affiliation. Hi, Ruthie. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
So, in the Israeli context, left-wingers and right-wingers tend to appropriate logical reasoning and blame the other side for being too driven by emotions. For example, rightists, and here I'm generalizing to the extreme, they claim that the plain truth is that all past efforts to make peace have failed and that leftists are delusional and hanging on to an unattainable optimistic vision. Whereas leftists, and here again I'm generalizing, they claim that a peaceful resolution to the conflict is the only thing that can ensure Israel's existence, and that the right-wingers who oppose it are driven either by unfounded romanticism or, worse, by childish vindictiveness. Now, who's right?
Well, obviously, each of us has their own views on these things, especially when we live here. But I do want to take to task one thing you said, that this distinction between being logically motivated or driven by emotion. Most research, not from the field of intergroup conflicts or political ideology, has found that emotions are actually very good tools for effective decision-making processing and reasoning processing. They contain a lot of information and they're very effective drivers for human action that actually save a lot of time because they're so effective and immediate. So it's not seen in the psychological literature as two opposing constructs, logic and emotion.
Yeah, but how do you define emotions, really? Is it, compassion or, any kind of,
Well, emotion,
enlighten me.
Emotions are they're multifaceted constructs. They're momentary reactions to something. It could be new information, new events, or the recollection of new events, but they're reactions to something concrete that involve both cognitive appraisal and some kind of physical arousal, or not necessarily arousal, but they also motivate certain action. They come with goals, and each emotion has its own profile in terms of the appraisals associated with it and what kind of action they drive people to.
Okay, so in the context of a conflict situation, how does it come about?
Well, for example, if I heard the news this morning, I could be very afraid of the news of an attack on Jews and feel afraid. And fear, for example, is actually a complicated emotion because it's associated with classically with flight or fight tendencies. So I could just try to hide at home and not go out because I'm afraid, but I could also support very aggressive action against the other side. And this is very typical in conflicts. But I could also hear the same news and instead of being afraid, be very angry because I could see it as an unjust event and think I need to correct this somehow.
But how does this translate into political action?
Well,
people are afraid and angry all the time.
Well, when you talk about people being afraid or angry all the time, you're talking about it's not momentary reactions. So it's not the classical definition of emotions. It's these things are often called long-term emotions or sentiments is the exact term. And that's not something that drives to action. That's almost an emotional attitude, something that people have
I don't mean all the time some state of mind, but I meant frequently.
Very frequently.
People, but these arousals are everywhere all the time.
That's true. So we can't always act when a partner makes you angry. You can often yell right away or do something or find a way to correct this wrongdoing. But when you're a member of a group and you're subject to decisions by politicians, you often can't do that. And the main way you can influence what happens is by lending support to certain policies or other policies.
Mm-hmm.
And we see these in democratic societies, especially in elections, but also referenda, public opinion polls, protests, various kinds of ways to influence how things happen.
And the patterns experienced by left-wingers and right-wingers are quite different.
Yes. The research we've come to talk about today doesn't deal with different patterns of experiencing emotions, though there are definitely findings about that. But what we were interested in understanding here is, given the same emotion, the same emotional experience, do the same emotions drive leftists and rightists equally to action or alternatively to supporting certain lines of policies, which is an alternative to action in these situations?
And?
Well, it's very interesting, and I think for many counterintuitive. And The New Yorker this past week had a very interesting article asking if social psychology was biased against conservatives. And there's conservatives are underrepresented in many ways. And a lot of the literature on ideology, not all of it, but much of it, is actually the main researchers in it openly admit to having more leftist views.
Yeah, it's a well-known theme in Marxist thought, ideology and its application. But never mind. Let's put it aside for a second.
So this question has been raised, and I was actually very happy to have just had this published research that doesn't have a very obviously leftist conclusion.
Mm-hmm.
And what we found, both when we manipulated emotions and raised different kinds of emotion, both negative and positive among leftists and rightists, and both when we looked at real-time events and the emotions they raise, that for leftists, the connection between the emotions they experienced and the policy they supported was stronger.
Mm-hmm.
So, for example, when we raised levels of empathy for everyone, and we successfully raised them for everyone by telling them about a Palestinian boy in need of surgery who may never be able to realize his dream of being a professional soccer football player.
Mm-hmm.
Even though everyone experienced more empathy in the empathy condition, this only translated into more support for conciliatory policies towards the Palestinians among leftists.
Mm-hmm.
With rightists, we found absolutely no difference in policy support between the two experimental conditions.
Mm-hmm.
And we found the same thing.
But isn't it a slanted example? Or are you going to talk about another example right now that maybe feeds better into the rightist scheme of events?
Well, in all of these studies, we found this pattern, that there was a greater relation between the emotions and the support for policies among leftists. But the empathy example is a problematic one, because empathy is considered a more leftist emotion. And maybe these leftist emotions or these positive emotions towards the out-group drive leftists and not rightists because of the tenets of the ideology. So we also manipulated despair.
Mm-hmm.
And we found that despair decreased support for gestures to the Palestinians only among leftists and not among rightists. And when we went to look at real-world events, we made sure to look at both positive and negative events. The first event we looked at was the lead-up to the Annapolis peace process in 2007.
Mm-hmm.
And we found there that more empathy among leftists predicted greater support for compromises as part of that peace process, but not among rightists, so much like the experimental studies. But we found the same for anger, that more anger among leftists predicted less support for compromises, but that didn't happen among rightists.
And how do you explain it?
How do we explain this?
Mm-hmm.
Well, the theory, the psychological theory on ideology views ideology not only as different beliefs that people adopt for socialization reasons, but in addition to top-down processes that lead people to adopt one ideology or another, there are also differing needs.
Mm-hmm.
And different ideologies answer needs in different ways. So what's been found across cultures, really pretty much everywhere that it's been tested, is that greater need for certainty or greater fear of ambiguity leads to a greater tendency to adopt rightist ideology. And one of the things that this may mean, and a lot of the findings indicate this is the case, that rightist ideology provides clearer answers to questions. It provides very, very clear and rigid guidelines as to how the world should be. And this provides certainty for people with a higher need for certainty. Mm-hmm. And actually, leftist beliefs, when examined by external judges, are found to be much more ambiguous. They don't answer this need for certainty. But what it also means is that emotions, as we said, they're temporary reactions. Emotions are intermittent factors that can be taken into account or not taken into account. Mm-hmm. But rightists, who have much clearer long-term guidelines, much more rigid, we believe they rely less on their emotions for information. It's not that they don't experience these emotions, and it's not necessarily that they're not, at least initially, motivated to act according to them. Mm-hmm. But they have a clear ideology to go back to. And at least in these very clear political contexts related to the conflict, which, as we know, in Israel is the most basic aspect of ideology. People decide where they are in the ideological spectrum according to their view on the Israeli-Palestinian conflict.
Yeah, I was just going to come to that in our context, there's a very clear indication of what makes a leftist and what makes a rightist. And that is, and I want to ask you, whether is that something that you accept and based your research on, is the, say, a sort of peaceful approach to resolving the conflict, or that is on the left, and on the right, something that is a bit more cautious. I mean, there is a certain willingness to resolve the conflict, just perhaps not in a conciliatory way.
Well, there are different costs that people are willing to take on themselves. I think that whenever you look at societies in conflict, and we often think we're the only ones, the Israelis and Palestinians, but a conflict that is in the process of being resolved in Northern Ireland is another very prominent example. And you have South Africa, you have ongoing conflicts in other places, in Sri Lanka, too many to count in Africa. Mm-hmm. And in all of these places where conflicts rage for decades, it becomes a very, very significant aspect of people's ideological identities, where they are on the conflict.
Yeah, but where do you place them? How do you brand someone as a leftist and the other as a rightist?
Well, we let people brand themselves. And this is what's been done also outside of conflict areas. In the main researcher that has brought back ideology back into the psychological spotlight is John Jost. In the U.S., he mostly deals with conservatives and liberals. Mm-hmm. But there's a spectrum between extreme right and extreme left, extremely conservative or extremely liberal.
And this applies
and
only...
people say place themselves on that spectrum.
And this applies only to conflict situations? Would you say that, I don't know, if the welfare state was being debated, would the distribution be rather similar?
In Israel?
In Western Europe, for that matter.
Well, so Jost's approach to ideology views ideology as something that takes on different contents in different cultures and different societies, but there's still a meaning to left and right, and that relates to what he terms an ideological superstructure, a universal superstructure for ideology in different places. And the basic distinctions there that divide left and right are to what extent people support or oppose change, and to what extent people tolerate or do not tolerate inequality.
Mm-hmm. I want to ask you perhaps a methodological question about, you mentioned earlier that you manipulated emotions.
Yeah.
How do you do that? And you know, even a more basic question: how do you measure emotions? How do you, I mean, what are the clinical conditions that would allow you to draw conclusions from that experiment?
Well, I'm not a clinical psychologist, but there's a lot of research on what's the right way or wrong way to measure emotions, because they're multifaceted constructs. You can do many things. You can check people's arousal. You can check various other physiological factors. There's a lot of research with brain activity. Mm-hmm. In social psychology, these approaches are sometimes taken, but very often very hard to utilize practically, especially with funding issues, etc. But also, when you want to differentiate between discrete emotions, and discrete emotions would be the difference between anger and hatred and fear and all these different things. And we're interested in these different discrete emotions because each one...
What do you mean discrete? How do you mean discrete?
The discrete emotion refers to a specific emotion rather than just having negative emotion or positive emotion, or just being highly aroused. Or, like, the fact that I have a negative emotion and I'm feeling high physical arousal doesn't mean whether I'm feeling fear or anger, for example.
Mm-hmm.
But fear and anger have very different behavioral outcomes. So often we want to understand, and the approach we take in my research lab and with my supervisors is this approach that looks at the specific emotions, because we believe that emotions are drivers for action and for policy support.
Mm-hmm.
So in all of these studies, we use self-report, especially when we wanted to get representative samples of Israelis. And we could do this either by phone or through the internet.
Mm.
It's the main way we could do it. We can't really ask people to connect themselves to EEGs.
Yeah.
But there are other approaches, and a lot of this research, people try to replicate it using other kinds of measures. So the self-report is a big thing here, and I think it's definitely a methodological concern, a concern that's being addressed a lot in the literature. But the fact that we've found this across so many contexts gives us a lot of confidence in these findings.
Mm-hmm. What contexts, such as what?
Well, we found it both within the lab, and you asked how we manipulated mm-hmm. empathy and fear. It's actually quite easy to raise emotions in the context of intergroup conflict. Empathy, you would think it was harder, but we just let participants read a text about a Palestinian boy who has knee pain.
Mm-hmm.
In the control condition, that knee pain turns out to be nothing serious, and within 2 weeks he can go back to his favorite sport, football. But in the empathy condition, it's much more serious. It's actually a malignant tumor, and he will never be able to play again. And we found this. We actually had two experiments in which we manipulated empathy in this way with two different outgroups. Once it was a Palestinian boy, once it was the son of Sudanese asylum seekers.
Mm-hmm.
And in both these situations, one related to a very ongoing violent conflict between groups, and another to intergroup conflict that's not tangible conflict,
mm-hmm.
But is still definitely an issue in Israeli society, we found this, that while everyone was able to feel more empathy to the boy in the more serious condition, that didn't translate into more support for constructive policies or humanitarian policies mm-hmm. in the asylum seeker condition.
And if that specific boy had been from the same group as them?
That's a very good question. We're very interested in my doctoral research focuses on the interrelations of emotions and ideology in intergroup conflict. So mm-hmm. we focus on these questions. But I think it's definitely a great follow-up question to see what happens when you raise emotions towards an in-group member.
Well,
what happens
inshallah
then?
One day. I want to ask you one last question. Did you the participants in your study were strictly Jewish Israelis, or were there...
We had...
Go on.
May I? Okay. We had six studies in the paper. The first five studies are all Jewish Israelis. This is the group to which I belong, the group I'm very interested in learning about. But we had a unique opportunity last year. There were massive protests against the Prower plan. It was a governmental plan that was officially meant to settle the issue of the Bedouin in the Negev, but mm-hmm. People within Palestinian society in Israel viewed it as another attempt to uproot Palestinians from their land, Palestinian mm-hmm. Bedouins specifically. And there were a lot of protests then, and this was a very fear-inducing situation. Palestinians saw this as a great threat to their existence and equality in the state. And what we found also among Palestinian citizens of Israel is that more fear was related to increased support for certain policies only among leftists, only mm-hmm. among Palestinians with more, you could say, dovish views.
Mm-hmm. When you talk about in-groups, perhaps a different approach of leftists and rightists to their in-groups is that leftists perhaps are more willing to see, Jewish Israeli leftists, that is, are more willing to see non-Jewish Israelis as perhaps part of their in-group, whereas the rightists, the Jewish Israeli rightists, see their in-group as strictly Jewish.
I think definitely you could find different approaches to categorization of these groups among left and right. But in the last two studies, one was conducted during not the last war in Gaza, but the one before, among Jewish Israelis, and the other was the study among Palestinian citizens of Israel. In both of these studies, we also had measure of identification with the in-group, and we found these results even when controlling for identification. So it wasn't just about how much you see your group, Jewish mm-hmm. or Palestinian, as your group, how important that that identification is to you. It's something beyond that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Ruthie Pliskin, I'm afraid this is all we have time for. So thank you very much for coming in. You're a social psychologist at Tel Aviv University and the Interdisciplinary Center in Herzliya. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
That was our show for this week. Thank you so much for listening. Also, big thanks to our technical producer, Adam Scher. I'm your host, Gilad Halpern, and do join me again next week for another edition of the Tel Aviv Review. In the meantime, do not forget to follow us on Facebook and Twitter, and don't hesitate to get in touch via Gilad, G-I-L-A-D, at tlv1.fm. Until then, goodbye. ולחיות את הרגע להתחיל לסוף את השברים אולי יצא יותר להתחיל קצת למים להתחיל להסתדר ולעשות קצת רעש אולי מקום אחר מקום יותר בועל להתחיל קצת לקלקל ולתקן עוד פעם מה הזמן מסמן זה הכל שריות של החיים ולחיות את הרגע להתחיל לסוף את השברים אולי יצא יותר להתחיל קצת למים להתחיל להסתדר ולעשות קצת רעש אולי מקום אחר מקום יותר בוער להתחיל קצת לקלקל ולתקן לקלקל ולתקן